Ganapataye Namaha Om Gung Gurubhyo Namaha Om Sam Saraswati Namaha Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Parambaram Samasta Jana Kalyani Niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Sadgurum Brahma Vidvaram. Om Parthaya Pratibodhitam Bhagavata Narayanena Swayam Vyasena Gradhitam Purana Munina Madhye Mahabharatam Advaitamritavarshinim Bhagavatim Ashtadashadhyayinim Ambatva Manusandadhami Bhagavad Gita Bhavadveshini Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langhayate Girim Yat Kripatamaham Vande Paramananda Madhavam Paramananda Madhavam. Hare Om Suprabhatam. Yesterday, we listened that the path of bhakti is open for all. Anyone. There's no restrictions. The person should be a brahmana or a kshatriya or a vaishya or a shudra or a panjama or a mlecha. Anyone. Stri, purusha, jnani, ajnani, papi, punyavan. All are equally welcome to this path. Now after this, Bhagavan Sri Ramanujacharya, a great saint, he says, of course, all are welcome here, but if we want to enjoy the aparabhakti, aparabhakti, where we feel the oneness with God in each and every moment of our existence. So, just think about it. What a state it would be. Now what we are thinking of all these wasteful thinking, are going on in our mind. The moment we are merged, Swami Krishna says, it is like putting one ghada inside an ocean. Inside and outside, you will only feel the presence of the supreme bliss. The entire thing goes out. Swami Krishna is like, making a charakya. I do not know what the word for charakya in English. It's a kind of fruit. Then, you can actually take out of the entire thing and then you can use it to store things. How it is possible, in a bhakta's life, when we are ready to take out all these negativities, all these wrong identifications, all those things out of our system, and then we are just only a shell, inside and outside, only the love of God exists. Even to imagine, it is such a wonderful feeling. Now, if we can actually experience it, what a wonder it will be. Our life will be nitya utsava. That's how Shastra says. It becomes nitya utsava. Each and every moment of our life will become a celebration. Why? We are with Him. He alone exists. Bhagavan Sri Ramanujacharya Swami gives us some tips. If you want to experience this aparabhakti, parabhakti, aparabhakti and mukhya bhakti, okay. But that parabhakti, how can we develop this? Bhagavan says there are six things, or six qualities, or six bhavas we should develop if we want to gain this parabhakti. Bhagavan says, if a being, a bhakta, who feels he is a limited entity, if he want to experience the para bhakti, knowingly, unknowingly. Sometimes this all happens unknowingly, because that is the beauty of bhakti. When our mind is, you know, in the state of that pure love for Bhagavan, all these things automatically come to us. The same time, you know, as a sadhaka, you know, Swamiji tell us what we should do. Acharya says, if these things you know, develop in our heart, slowly that parabhakti also will come to us. What is the first one? First one is viveka. Like, you know, in Vedanta Paddhati also, first we should do have viveka. What is viveka? Nitya, anitya, vastu. What is nitya and what is anitya? What is eternal and what is perishable? We should know that. Now I should know that this sharira is perishable. One day this sharira is going to fall. And all those relations, all those things, all those people who we say our near and dear, they are all based on this sharira. My mother became my mother when I entered to this sharira. Father, wife, husband, children, everything. How they all came up in our life? Because we are in this sharira. The moment we go out of this sharira, there's no wife is no more wife, husband is no more husband. It's done. So we should know what is nitya and what is anitya. This viveka should be there. This viveka is the base of any kind of spiritual, you know, journey. This is our, what you call, the capital with us. What is nitya, what is anitya? Oh, I have a lot of viveka. You know everything, what is anitya, anitya. I can write a paper also on that. It is not just knowing, it is feeling. You know, when you take away something from me, I should be able to study myself, because I know that vastu belongs to me. I feel belongs to me because that vastu is somehow is attached to this body, related to this body, not with me. Whatever. So, viveka is not just an understanding, viveka is a feeling. So when viveka is there, then what happens? Vimoha happens. Vimoha happens. Now we are deluded. Moha is there. What is the moha? This is my book. This is my book. If you take away. So, why moha is there in this, not only in this book, in this sharira. Let us think, we leave out all these things. In this sharira we have moha, that this is me. What we say, my body. But our moha is, this is me, isn't it? Now, when we speak, we say, don't touch my body. My body is paining. So, somehow that Bhagavan has given us this knowledge, in maybe in the unconscious level, that we are not this. That's why I say my. When I say my book is not me, that I know. My shirt is not me, I know. So when I say my body, so I know that I am not this. But some kind of a moha comes and then we feel, why are you touching me? No, I have not touched you. I touched you only body only. But this is known as moha. Atasmin tap buddhihi iti avochama. Shankaracharya says, what is this moha, delusion you are talking about? It is atasmin tap buddhihi. The feeling of oneness or that in something else. Atasmin tat buddhihi. Like, when we got frightened seeing a snake. Actually, there was no snake, only a rope was there. So, in rope, we felt snake is there. Because of that, we got frightened. Isn't it? Like that, we have this wrong notion of something or something else. It is known as the moha. So, if you want to really develop the love for Bhagavan, the pure love and experience of, see, here in the level of para, it is not just a knowledge, in the para, it is an experience. Okay, with our little intellect, we may not actually able to understand what it is. But, rishis tell us, this is an experience, I have experienced it. You also shall experience it. How? First is viveka, second is vimoha. The vimoha in our Vedantic, we say vairagya. One only. Vigadaha rahaha, vigadaha mohaha. Vimoha. Now comes the most important thing. What is that? That is abhyasa. It's a very funny thing, Now we are, not me, you all speak very good English. After how many years, you have learned English for how many years? And then, now you can, speak English very well. Now somebody comes to us and says, Swamiji, nothing is working. What is not working? My sadhana. Oh, what happened? I am doing japa for 1 week. Can you believe? 1 week I am doing japa and I am not able to see God. Sir, 1 week, yes, I did 1 week. They feel that doing 1 week of japa is a big thing. To learn a language, you took so many years. To know God, you want to know God in 1 week? Says, abhyasa. Bhagavan Sri Patanjali says, how we can actually, abhyasa means practice. No, abhyasa is practice. How long we should do the practice? We do not know. that is the thing. There are things which are not known to us, which are kept in darkness for us. Why? That's good for us, that's why. So, abhyasa, Bhagavan Patanjali says, dirghakala mairandarya asevitaha dritabhumihi. You take up any kind of spiritual practice. Not only spiritual practice, any practice. You want to become a good singer. One day you will become a good singer. 2 days, 10 days, 1 month, 1 year. So, To become a good singer, you need at least 10, 20 years to become really, you know. And then to see God, says, Dirgha Kala. Oh, Swamiji, I am doing the practices for 25 years. Nothing happens. Sir, when did you do? The moment I get up from my bed, I do it for 5 minutes. And the moment I go for, just before, you know, retiring, I do for 5 minutes. Says, not only Dirgha Kala, Nairandharya. Sometimes all of us, I will not say you, all like me, people like me, sometimes no, we are so much thrilled and then we do puja, japa, dhyana for 12 hours, 13 hours. Ah. Then there comes a time, not even 1 minute we do. We get bored with this. Ah. Isn't it? There is a break. In our spiritual practice, for some time we do and then we stop. Actually, you know, we came into, we do not know, na? So we have almost reached there, then we feel, no, we have reached up to this, then we feel, oh, then we fall back. Says, Nairandaryam, Nirantarata should be there in our spiritual practices. And how we should do spiritual practice? Oh, that's Guru told me I have to do this 5 mala. Doing mala, no? Like this, I'm doing mala. And many times I see like this. How many more is there? Well, actually I don't want to do this. But I will do this because, you know, somebody said, oh, you know, I have some respect for my guru, or I feel that I will come out of this trouble because if I do that. Not because of love. That asevanam is not there. Asevitaha means what? You should enjoy each and every moment of your spiritual practice. When you do for, sit for japa, when you sit for meditation, when you sit for your puja, when you do anything, do it with wholeheartedly. Do not do it for someone else's sake. When this happens, then alone, Siddhi, not all the Siddhi, we will be able to actually progress in our spiritual life. Please remember this. Dirgha Kala Nairandarya Hasevitaha Dridhabhumihi. Then it's sure 100% guaranteed that we shall realize, experience the supreme truth. That is, you know, not the politician's words, this is the words of rishis, which is 100% true. That is abhyasa. We should practice. We should take up different kinds of spiritual practices, disciplines. Then we come to a stage, all disciplines vanish. But, as a, you know, like when you are learning Carnatic music, hours and hours you do sadhana. And then you come to a very high level, then the different shruti, different ragas manifest through you. You don't even think whether I should this raga, that raga. The raga flows through you. But it will not happen in the beginning. You have to, you have to practice. You have to practice abhyasa. Then comes kalyana. Sri Bhagavan Ramanujacharya says, you know, if we really want to enter into this, what you say, the abode of the Lord, which is known as Parabhakti, we need Kalyana. What is Kalyana? Kalyana is purity. Purity in our thought. We shouldn't, there are people who does lots of sadhanas. Why? Because I want to destroy him. I want to destroy that person. I want to make lot of money. There are people, no? They do such wonderful sadhanas for years. But they may get all that. But not Parabhakti. You may have Viveka, Abhyasa, everything. But if Kalyana is not there, your mind is not pure, you shall not enter into the into the abode of the Lord. Our mind, why we are doing this? Now, so whenever we should be very, what is the difference between a sadhaka and an ordinary person? A sadhaka is very conscious of his thoughts. Of course, he should be very careful about his words and deeds, but more than his words and deeds, he should be very alert about his thoughts. What kinds of thoughts are forming in my head? Very important. That's why we always pray, Tanme mana shiva sankalpamastu. O Bhagavan, me manaha shiva sankalpamastu. Me only shiva, auspicious thoughts come to me. My God, this is my prayer. Tanme mana shiva sankalpamastu. So when we do any karma, we always pray, Tanme mana shiva sankalpamastu. The karma is not important, but sankalpa is very important. The thoughts, we are whoever we are because of our thoughts. Says Bhagavan here, Kalyana. Kalyana is purity in the level of word, deed and thought. Of course, our words should be Shuddha, our karma should be Shuddha, that's possible. But most important thing is, what kinds of thoughts are going through our mind? Sri Vivekananda ji says, when its thought is like a, like a line. In our psychic, in our mind, when one thought goes, it's just a line. And when you repeat that thought, it becomes a channel. Now, it becomes a channel through which your mind will flow. Repeat any kind of thoughts, whether positive or negative. So it's become kind of a river bed through which our mind, our emotions, our thoughts naturally starts to flow. That's very important. What kind of thoughts are there? Says Bhagavan, Kalyana. Very important. Then Bhagavan says, Anavasadaha. Anavasadaha means, see, don't think, sometimes you want to become, you want to, enter into this Indian administrative service, suppose. You have to go through how many tests? You have to study so much. You have to go through different tests and different, after the test also training. There are many, many hurdles we have to cross over, isn't it? Just to become an IAS. Now, if you want to become, God's person, do you think that there will be less tests? No. There will be lots and lots and lots of exams. If you want to, see, as long as you just want to go to temple, put all these things, do namaskar and Hare Rama, Hare Rama, hello, how are you, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, it's all okay. We are not talking about such people, we are talking about a person who really want to live in God. For him, there will be many tests in his life. So who can actually come into that point where actually we feel connected with Lord? Most important thing is titiksha. I think you have already discussed this. Titiksha, anavasadaha means anavasadaha, na avasadaha means we never feel that enough. That is known as anavasadaha. Means that power, that mental capacity for us to catch on. Even if things goes wrong, everything shatters, everything was so good. The moment I started up this journey, so many things are coming up. You should have that power to face them and overcome them. No? You know, take refuge at the lotus feet of Bhagavan and never leave, whatever may happen in this life, never leave the feet of Lord. That firm conviction, that firm dedication is known as anavasada. In other words, titiksha. So we have, other days, no, tharogapi sahishnuna. No, a sadhaka, a bhakta should be able to, you know, bear insults, you know, bear injury, bear different kinds of, adharma. Sometimes we think, I am a bhakta and these all things happen. So what? You are a bhakta, so what? So if you are a bhakta, then comes the real test. So, but understand that Bhagavan is always there with us. You know, helping us, giving us inspiration. Don't leave and run. Bhagavan will see that we cross over these hurdles. But that conviction should be there. That is known as anavasada. Then comes the another one. Is known as anuddarsha. Anuddarsha means absence of pride. Ahankara vihinata. This is a very important feature for a bhakta. Anuddarsha. Anuddarsha where ahankara is not there. Ahankara means not the ahankara, ahankara. The ahankara, what we say, the pride. No? Oh, brahmanoham aham jnani. No? Yakshe dasyami modishche itya jnana vimohitaha. I am a brahmana, I am a kshatriya, I am a raja, I am the owner of this entire estate, I have four cars and this and that and, you know, how much ahankara, we gather in our life, says Bhagavan, if you want to enter, yesterday also we studied, we should be ready to give up our covers. All these are covers. We are covering ourselves with all these kinds of notions. No, I belong to a community, I am this and I am that. Actually, we are not that all. You know, all those things are just based on this mind and this body. We are just assuming ourselves. If you want to enter into this real aspect of bhakti, we should have that courage to give up all identifications and pride. When that happens, when all these things slowly develop in us, see, one thing is, we try. The moment we try a bit, the Lord gives us, they say, when we put one step ahead, the God comes near us 10 steps. That's the kind of ratio. Otherwise, these all things are not that easy, Little bit of viveka is possible, little bit of vimoha is possible. This all for little bit from our side. From the absolute sense, only by the grace of Lord, these things can be achieved. Little bit. Somebody says us some wrong things. Calm and quiet. Ah, mind is looking. Of course, inside we'll get agitated, but at least outside, keep quiet. After some time, we tell our mind, so what? Mind also get. But this is not sabhyasa. Okay? After some time, even when people say anything, we don't even, when the Rana gave the poison to Meera, and Meeraji knew that it was poison, she said, okay, if this is what Giridhar want me to drink, I will drink it. That is a very different kind of a level where grace is already with us. But what is our thing? Little bit of, calm, be little calm, little quiet, do little bit of practice, that is what we should do. Then from the absolute sense, things comes to us by the grace of Lord. New year present from Bhagavan. So, these are the, according to Bhagavan, different aspects of things which we should be careful about our life. And now let us continue through our pilgrimage through Gita. Yesterday we were discussing about 7th chapter, 8th chapter, 7th and 8th over. Today we will start with the 9th chapter. 9th chapter is one of the most important chapter of Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavan says this, Rajavidya Rajaguhya, the most sacred and secret knowledge of Gita. Why? Because it is very, very important for us. This is a chapter all of us should really, you know, learn. In this chapter, see, there are many things are discussed. All things are very beautiful, but we don't have time to go to each and everything. The 13th verse of the 9th chapter. Bhagavan says, please repeat, Mahatmanastu Mam Partha.
Mahatmanastu Mam Partha.
Daivim Prakriti Mashritaha.
Daivim Prakriti Mashritaha.
Bhajantyananya Manasu. Nyatva Bhutadi Mavyayam. Bhajanti. Who is a bhakta? A bhakta is a person who does bhajan. No, he always worship. Bhajanti mam. Whom does he worship? Mam. The supreme truth, supreme lord. Here, mam do not refer to Krishna, okay? Krishna means a Vasudeva Putra. Because some verses before he says, Avajanandi mam mudha manushim tanu mastitaha. Just some verses before. So Bhagavan want to tell us, when I am using this aham, mam, etc. in Srimad Bhagavad Gita, I am not talking as Devaki Putra, that cowherd boy, okay? Here Bhagavan is Bhagavan. Shri Krishna is revealing this sacred knowledge from the level of God, Ishwara, not as a person. So, whenever we say Avajanandi Mam Mudha means not that Devaki Putra Gita, Devaki Putra Krishna, but here it is Bhagavan, Ishwara. Okay, Mam Bhajanti, they worship. So, who are those people worship me? How they worship me? Ananya Manasaha, that's a key word here. Bhajanti everybody, but Ananya Manasaha. Ananya manasa means what? Ananya manasa means the mind which is not deviated. Now, this is a key word for us to meditate on Bhagavan. We also do bhajan. Okay? We also do bhajan, but if we analyze ourselves, why we do bhajan, then we understand that there are different motives. Isn't it? Sometimes we do bhajan because of we want to get rid of, you know, difficulties from our life, etc. Sometimes we do bhajan because we want some happiness, joy. Sometimes we do bhajan because we want to be peaceful. But there is always, there is a reason, isn't it? When we do bhajan, we want something. Here, Bhagavan says, who is the real lover of mine is, he is not doing bhajan, not to even to get peace. He just worship me because he love me. He love me, so he worship. Ananya manasaha. So one meaning of ananya manasaha is without any ulterior motives. Without any, you know, desire to gain something. I am not doing my spiritual practices, japa, dhyana, to gain something. No. I am doing it because this is my expression of you. You know, Sri Ramakrishna used to love Vivekananda, not that of Narendra, so much, too much. No, when the moment Sri Ramakrishna used to see Vivekananda, he will actually literally will dance. So much was his love. And then when he comes, he with his hands he will feed him. It was a different kind of a relation. And one day, Vivekananda came, Vivekananda and Narendra came, and Sri Ramakrishna not even looked at him, not talked to him, not looked at him. Like that, many days passed. Still, whenever Narendra used to get time, he used to come. After many days, Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna asked Narendra, "See, I was not talking to you. I was not even, you know, looking at you. I was not paying any attention to you. Why are you coming again?" Narendra was very, he said, "You see, I come here because I love you. Whether you love me or not, it's not a problem for me. Whether you love or not, that is, and it's up to you. But I love you, so I come." This is known as Ananya Bhakti. I love Bhagavan, so I worship him. It's not there to get something. Bhagavan, you know, Srimha Swami is seated, and then all that entire universe is going to burn because of his anger. And Devadas asked Mahalakshmi, she said no. Then they asked Prahlada, "Please, you know, Bhagavan took this form only for you. Now go and do something." So poor boy, you know, 5-6 years, so he went there, and then he started to praise Bhagavan. Seeing this boy, he threw away all that you know, carcass of that Hiranyakashipu, etc., and kept him on his thigh and started to lick him. Just like, have you seen cats? No, cats lick their kitten. Like that, Simha also does. And Bhagavan, he started to lick, you know, just see, Bhagavan, such a huge form, such a Narasimha, you know, and say the small boy is sitting and Bhagavan is licking. Bhagavan is so loving. He felt that I became a little late to come to rescue you from this horrible Rakshasa. And then Bhagavan asked him, "Now I'm so pleased with you. You asked me something. I want to give you a boon." Bhagavan, very, very touching. Sri Prahlada says, "Bhagavan, I am not a merchant. No, I am not a merchant. I am not here to sell my love and get something in return." There are people like that. You ask them, you give boon to anyone. "I am not a merchant, Bhagavan. My only prayer to you, if you want to give me any boon, my only prayer is, when you ask test like this, asking, you know, for you ask something, no, may my mind will not have any desire to ask from you. This is the only prayer I have." That is known as Ananya Manasaha. Without any mind, no, without any ulterior motive. One meaning is Ananya Manasaha means what? With loving Bhagavan only for Bhagavan's sake. In mind, there are no other motives. Next meaning of Ananya Manasaha is a mind which is only focused on Bhagavan. No other thoughts are there in our mind. No. One thing is, we worship him. There is no mind, means there is no desires in our heart. Another is, that's from negative aspect. From positive aspect, what it is? It is continuous flow. Taila dhara vat. You know, our mind is constantly in tune with the Lord. Ananya manasaha. That is the key word in this. You know, says that Mahatma, such people, whose mind is focused on me and there are no different kinds of desires in their heart, such people are Mahatmana. Bhagavan says they are Mahatmas. They are great people, great men of wisdom. Daivim prakriti mastitaha. How this is possible? To concentrate on Lord, giving up all other attachments. How it is possible? Bhagavan says, when you take Daivi prakriti, in 16th chapter, Daiva Asura Sambat is there. Now, different qualities which we should develop, like all these. Now, when we develop those Daivika Sambatti, some 24 qualities are said in the 16th chapter, Abhayam sattva samsuddhihi jnana yoga vyavasthidihi. Like that, Bhagavan explains in 16th chapter. When we take refuge in Daivi Sampatti, means what? All virtues. Daivi Sampatti means what? All virtues. So there, Swami Shivananji always used to say, if you want to become a spiritual person, first become a gentleman. Be a good person. You know, please don't think that, you know, I can do whatever I want to do in this world and then I will see God. No. Unless we develop virtues, daivim prakriti mastitaha, unless the daivika prakriti, the divine qualities, no, are in us. Unless we assimilate the divine qualities into us, ananya manastvam is not possible. That's the connection. Mahatmanastu mam partha daivim prakriti mashtitaha. The moment we become, you know, become a gentleman. Be a gentleman first. Then be a, you know, compassionate one. Then slowly let us think about all other spiritual things. Says Bhagavan, and Advayam Bhudadim Nyatu. Then he will come to know, what he will come to know? That Nyatva Bhudadim Advayam. They will come to know me as the imperishable truth, which is the source of all this created existence. When our mind is pure, we are filled with the divine qualities, and with an unwavered attention when we worship Him, we realize this entire universe came from Him, exists in Him, and goes back to Him, and He is beyond. Whether this universe exists or not, He shall be always there. Now, when this kind of a feeling comes to us, we realize the Lord in this way, then how we react, how we live in this world, says next loka, satatam kirtayanto mam. 14th verse of the 9th chapter. Yatandascha dridhavrataha namasyandascha mam bhaktya nitya yukta upasate. How they live in this world? They upasate. Their daily life in this world becomes an upasana. Upasana is not only just sitting in our puja room and doing puja, but each and every moment of our existence become a upasana of the Lord. Upasanam, sitting near, you know, worshipping, you know, a spiritual practice it become. How he does the upasana? Satatam kirtayantaha. We will be always, you know, praising the Lord. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Not just say praise the Lord, praise the Lord. What do you mean by that? Means each and every word of us will be a praise of God. What do you mean by that? Means any word which comes out of our mouth will be soaked with the love of God. You may be, such a bhakta may be speaking to a person, but each and every word he utters become a nama of Bhagavan. How? Because he, you know, we see the God in him. So each and every vachana becomes a pushpa, an offering at his lotus feet. Says satatam kirtayadaha. Otherwise, is it possible to do kirtana of Lord always? What means is, any word utters, comes out of our mouth, is in praise of Lord. Means what? It's an adoration of Lord. So when you are talking to a person who is crying, you know, you are trying to console him, that is a kirtana of Lord. Please don't say, Hare Rama alone is kirtana. No. When you speak on Gita, when you are talking to another person about Bhagavan, when you try to lead a person into the right path, each and every word, that's all our kirtan. Satatam kirtayandascha, yatandascha. Always trying. Trying for what? Trying to keep the mind in Lord. See, we have to do many things, isn't it? That's a very beautiful story again by Sri Ramakrishna. There was one mother, one very old lady. She used to come to meet Sri Ramakrishna. When Sri Ramakrishna, now we say Sri Ramakrishna, etc., etc., but when she was alive, people used to think him as a mad priest. That's what people used to call. You know, if they come and ask, where Sri Ramakrishna stay, they do not know. Who? Sri Ramakrishna? Who is that? Oh, that mad priest. Okay. That mad priest is in that room. People used to think like that. No, they used to do all kinds of things. Now we say, but a few, very few actually understood him. But there was one mother, old mother, she used to come to meet Sri Ramakrishna. And one day, she got some private time with Sri Ramakrishna, and she asked Bhagavan, see, I tried my best. It's not that I am not trying, but I am not actually able to worship him. No, I am not able to really constantly remember him. Satatam, no, kirtayandaha, yatandaha. This is not possible for me. It's not possible. I'm trying, but it's not happening. Why it's not happening? She said, in my house, there are lots of work. Okay, I have a grandson. He's very naughty. No, he's just only 1 or 2 years old. And I have to be always with him. Otherwise, he will turn the house upside down. So such a naughty one he is. And I don't have even 5 minutes for myself to do my japa or tapa. Now, what should I do? Now, this is known as grace. Okay. Sri Ramakrishna looked at the eyes of that mother and said, oh, my dear, understand that grandson is Krishna. Where is Krishna? Krishna is not, somewhere staying in some place. Understand that your grandson is Krishna. No, because when we say something happened, but when a Mahatma said, she got that conviction that this is Krishna. Says, after some months, maybe some time, in one other place, Sri Ramakrishna saw this mother and Sri Ramakrishna prostrated in front of her. Why? Because Bhagavan knew that he had reached. So, spiritual life is in one way, it's very easy. But from another way, it's very tough. See, spiritual life, especially in Bhakti Pada, they don't ask you to come out of house, renounce everything. No, wherever you are, we can practice. Why? Because in Bhakti Pada, it is not going to some place, doing some different kind of, it's changing our attitude. Sometimes, mothers are there or you are there. We do a lot of things. Now, you prepared a nice payasam, understanding that it's your son's birthday. But son is already grown up. But for you always, son is your son, child. So you made payasam, which he used to like. And then, you serve that payasam. And he says, I don't want this. And then your heart is broken. Why? Can't he just say one thanks to me? Now, this is one. Now, take into all other relationships, all other works of your life. Why our heart is broken so many times? Because we expect. things and feelings and understand things and everything from others. That's not wrong. From the worldly point, it's right. From spiritual point, understand that. See, when you are cooking, you are not cooking for your husband. You know, when you are doing some, you know, you think about, you know, some, and you are working something, it's not for your wife or children. Understand that your wife, your husband, your children, all are none other than Sri Bhagavan. So you are not doing this, whatever you are doing, is not for your wife, you are not for your husband, not you are for child. When you are cooking, when you are doing something, when you are planning something, when you are building up something, do it only for God. Because God is not an another particle. Which is, no, they try to find out now, what is this God particle? There is not a God particle which is different from us. This is the secret. We may try hundreds and hundreds of years and we will not actually find out a God particle. Because the moment you say God particle is there, which is different, that means the God is gone. There is no God as such. And I say this, please don't misunderstand me. What I am trying to tell you is, God is everywhere. It is one. What we see is nothing other than God. And when we actually change our life, attitude, thinking, then we are always in the presence of God. Whatever we are doing, then it becomes adoration. That's when satatam kirtayanda. This satatam goes to each word. Satatam kirtayandaha, satatam yatantaha, satatam dhritavrataha. Again, of course it's not easy for us to begin. Sometimes we do, then we forget. Again and again and again. You know, dhritavrataha, namasyantaha, ya satatam namasyantaha, prostrating in front of each and every one. Why? Because it's not a kind of showing off, you know. It is because he actually sees Bhagavan in each and every being. Namasyandaha. Never hurt. Even if people hurt us, never hurt back. Because, this is only for a, you know, if you really want to feel that, one with it, then namasyandaha, because we prostrate in front of each one, each being. We cannot hurt anyone because in everyone, my beloved Krishna is in the form of all this. And how can I hurt someone? Namasyandascha nityayuktaha. My mind is now always joined with the Lord. Bhaktya mam upasate. That's how, that's known as bhakti. Bhakti is not that we go to temple once in a day, once in a year, or go to Shabarimala, and then we do some bribing of Bhagavan and do japa for 1 minute in the day. That is not bhakti. Bhakti is satatam. See, satatam kirtayandoscha yatandascha dhudhavrataha namasyandascha mam bhaktya. Nityayukta means what? It's not for some time, always upasate. That is upasana. Then Bhagavan, take us to any very important declaration of Bhagavan. Bhagavan says, verse 22, 9th chapter 22. Ananyas chindayando maam. Ye janaah paryupasate, tesham nityabhiyuktanam, yogakshemam vahamyaham. We'll just see the meaning and then we'll continue next class. Anan ye janaha, those people, ananyah. Therefore, their life there was no one else. Na anyaha, ananyaha. Mam chindayantaha. meditating upon me, paidi upasate, again and again and again, continuously worship me, nityabhiyuktanam tesham, nitya abhiyuktanam, whose mind is constantly merged in me. Of those people, yoga and kshema, aham vahami. I shall take care of yoga and kshema, the welfare of such people. This is a very famous, at least this line, yoga kshema vahami, because of LIC, no? Life Insurance Corporation, yoga kshema vahami, very good. But this is Bhagavan's pratijna. Bhagavan says, don't worry, my child. I shall take care of you. I shall take care of you. But there are other things. What is that? Ananyaschindanam, Pradyupasanam, Nityabhiyuktam. When these three things are there, Bhagavan takes care of our yoga and kshema. What is yoga, Swamiji? What is kshema? That we'll see evening class. Let us sit for a minute, calm and quiet, and remember, Lord, try to go through the entire class, essence of today's class, and then we'll conclude.
Avinayamapanay Vishnu Damayamana Samaya Vishaya Mriga Trishna Bhutadayam Vistaraya Taraya Samsara Sagarata.
O Bhagavan, please fill our heart with modesty. Please open our eyes to see your eternal presence in this universe. May my mind and my indriyas naturally turn towards you. May I understand the true nature of this samsara, which is changing at each and every moment. May Lord bless me so that I see the adhisthana on which all these changes take place. Oh God, please thy grace is with me, so that I walk the path of dharma. May my mind be filled with divine thoughts and feelings. May I be able to see your presence in each and every moment. Oh God, oh Bhagavan, please be with us in this journey of unknown.
Namadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavasishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.